Welcome back to our series on visualization, identification, and estimation in the linear panel event study design. In this video, we are going to talk about ways to identify the causal effect of the policy when you may be concerned about endogeneity of the policy. In particular, we will discuss identification strategies that do not rely on proxies or instruments today. The equation of interest looks as follows. We observe a panel data set where by YIT, we denote the outcome variable. Alpha I is a unit fixed effect. Gamma T here is a time fixed effect. QRT are observed covariates. The policy variable is going to be denoted by Z. Note that it enters through leads and lags here, thereby allowing for dynamic effects of the policy. The epsilon IT is just a standard error term that we're going to assume is well behaved and we're going to largely ignore throughout the talk. The CIT is the interesting part and can lead to endogeneity. You can think of it as an unobserved confound, and that's how we're going to refer to it throughout. It may be related to both the policy Z and the outcome Y. Because it's unobserved, clearly the parameters of interest beta here are not going to be identified unless we can say more about this confound. So in order to identify the beta, we need to make additional assumptions. And these identifying assumptions are just restrictions on this confound. And that's how I will express them throughout this talk. Note that these assumptions or these restrictions on the confound are generally going to be untestable, and they should therefore be justified based on economic grounds. Now, in general, two classes of identification strategies are available here. Today, I'm going to think about restrictions that impose sufficient structure on the confound so that the parameters beta can be identified without the use of proxies or instruments. If you do have access to proxies or instruments, a number of alternative identification strategies become available, and we will discuss those in the next video on identification with proxies or instruments. Now, in the first class of restrictions I'm going to consider, I will assume that the confound is low dimensional. Now, you can see that by noting up here that the FT does not depend on I. So what that means is that the confound represents aggregate shocks or factors affecting all units. Again, this will usually have to be motivated on economic grounds. And I will distinguish three versions of these assumptions. The simplest one, case A here, is one where aggregate shocks affect all units equally and where unit-specific effects are time invariant. In such a case, we can proceed by estimating our linear panel model with simple two-way fixed effects, because the two types of fixed effects absorb the aggregate and unit-specific but time-invariant effects. So to add some economic content here, the time-fixed effects might represent the effects of confounding macroeconomic shocks or changes in federal policy. And then this sort of case A here implies that these factors influence all units, for example, all states, in the same way. It therefore rules out models in which the influence of aggregate factors may depend on unit-level features such as say the sectoral composition of the local economy. So for example, suppose we're estimating the effect of the minimum wage at the state level on something like the youth unemployment rate. So minimum wage is the policy variable Z here, and the youth unemployment rate is the outcome of interest Y. Now the confound could be the overall macroeconomic condition in the US in the sense that 10 states tend to increase the minimum wage when the US economy is strong, but it's also affected to the youth unemployment rate in each state. Now to do so, in case A here, we require this overall macroeconomic condition to have similar effects on the youth employment rate for all states. Okay. Now in case B, which I'm going to turn to next, we relax this condition and allow the aggregate factors to affect different units differently. But instead, we require the factors to have a known functional form here. So for example, we may assume that they follow a linear trend. In that case, we can estimate our linear panel model by adding unit-specific linear trends to the estimating equation. So to sort of stick with my previous economic example, the state fixed effects alpha I accounted for time invariant state-specific differences in the youth employment rate, and the time fixed effects gamma T accounted for overall macroeconomic conditions in the US. So we've discussed that before. But we may further want to allow for state-specific differences in trends in the youth employment rate. In order to do so, we would take FT here as just a linear trend. So this clearly is more flexible than case A, but nevertheless, one needs to come up with a reasonable trend structure here and justify why the chosen trend structure plausibly approximates the latent sources of confounding we may be worried about. Now, in case C down here at the bottom, we treat the time-varying confound Ft as unknown and don't impose any known functional form. So the confound consists of common shocks, and units can respond differently to those shocks. Now, one caveat I should mention here is that this kind of type of setting in under case C here generally is going to require more data. But anyways, under case C, we can estimate our linear panel model via common correlated effects, interactive fixed effects, or synthetic control methods. So the methods under this case C are appealing when the latent confound is thought to arise from aggregate factors again, such as macroeconomic shocks, but when these shocks may affect all units to a different extent. So for instance, in our minimum wage example, we may again be concerned that states tend to increase the minimum wage when the economy is strong. And case C captures this concern by allowing that the state of the aggregate economy, that's the capital FT here, actually has different effects on the local economy, in particular the youth employment in different states. Note that what these three cases all had in common is that the endogeneity arises here because of common trends or shocks, right? There was always this kind of common macroeconomic aggregate factor working in the background that's causing the endogeneity. And while I highlighted some economic scenarios where maybe that's plausible, in other settings, the confound we are concerned about will be specific to the individual. Now, in such a world, one approach is to assume that the projection of the confound into event time has a known structure and can be learned from pre-event data alone. Then we can extrapolate the event time part of the confound into the post-event periods. And so effectively, we are assuming there is an event time trend in the outcome, and our causal estimates would be relative to this event time trend. Another way to think about it is that we can exploit the fact that any relationship between the policy and the outcome, more than g periods in advance, so without any anticipatory effects prior to the event, is only due to confounding. And we can thus use those periods to learn the parameters phi over here. Okay, so we can use the pre-event periods to learn these parameters phi. Of course, once we know phi, it's easy to extrapolate the counterfactuals post-event. Now, obviously, this is a pretty high-level assumption here. It's a little clunky to write down, so let me give you a concrete example where I think it's going to maybe make more sense. Suppose this is the event time path of the outcome. Now, of course, from this plot alone, we don't know what the confound looks like after event time minus one, because it's confounded there with the effect of the policy. But suppose we're willing to assume that the confound has a linear event time path. Then we can learn the slope of that linear path from the periods leading up to the event, right? So from this part of the figure, we can learn the slope of this linear event time path, which means we can estimate that slope and we can add it to the event study plot as I've done here. So now the difference between the point estimates post events, so these points up here, so sort of this difference over here and this difference over here, gives us the causal estimate. Since the red line now gives us the counterfactual, this is where the outcome was headed if the confound had continued its linear trend that we estimated from pre-event data. So subtracting this line down here from the points up here gives us our causal estimate. And that picture would then look like this. Okay. Now, before I wrap up, I want to re-emphasize that clearly the assumption that the confound continues linearly post-event is untestable and will have to be defended based on economic grounds. So let's relate this back to the concrete example of minimum wage again, where the confound might again reflect the state of the local economy, which affects both passage of a higher minimum wage and the youth unemployment rate. Okay, so under the assumption of linear extrapolation, we assert that for every state, the state of the local economy evolves linearly and has the same slope relative to passage of a higher minimum wage. So in each state, the state of the economy was on this linear trajectory over here and would have continued to evolve along that linear event time path absent an increase in the minimum wage. Now, before I leave you, I want to briefly demonstrate how to implement this linear extrapolation estimator using our package in Stata. So for that, I've preloaded an example data set here that uses the same notation for all variables that we've seen in the slides. So we start by running our standard event study that depicts the events time path of the outcome. To do that, we simply type xd event, declare outcome variable, declare panel variable and time variable, declare our policy variable, which is still denoted by Z here. And we declare the window length for our estimation. And that estimates our event study. Now, to look at the corresponding event study plot, we run XD event plot, and we get this figure over here. Now, if you think that the way to get causal estimates here is to estimate this model relative to a common event time trend, we can run the following. Again, XD event, declare the outcome variable, declare the panel variable, time variable, and policy variable. Also declare window length. And additionally, I'm going to add this trend command here, plus the number 3 here that says -3. What this does is it uses the 3 time periods prior to the event to learn the slope of the event time trend. And if we estimate that, this is the estimation output. And then based on that, we can create 2 kinds of plots here, either one where we overlay the event time path of the outcome with the estimated linear event time trend. We would do so as follows, XD event plot. And we want to see an overlay plot with the trend. And that gives us this figure over here. Okay. Or we can directly subtract one from the other, or we can directly subtract this linear extrapolated line from our point estimates to get an event study plot of our causal estimates. To do that, we simply type XD event plot. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope you found it helpful for your research.